So thank you for the invitation. So I will skip the plan because I don't know if I will be able to follow. So there was a problem which was asked me, the Ekron Simon conjecture. So what it is, I'm sorry, it begins quite abstract, but we will see it will go back to graph since everything can go back to graph according to some people here. So we take just a probability space, a general probability space, and you have an operator acting on L2 of mu, mu being probability. And we assume that it is a self-adjoint, and it's said to be Markovian if these two properties are satisfied. Positive is preserved. If I have a function which is positive, it remains positive. And the vector which is always taking the value 1, it's transformed into itself. So, well, for people used to finite stuff, M, S, and we will come back to this situation. In fact, think of S a finite set. You have a measure, positive measure on your finite set, and M is just a matrix such that every entry is non-negative, and the sum of all the entries on the line is 1. And this is just a generalization to that. So since we assume that it was self-adjoint, the good question will be at the end, what if it is only invariant? But no, it will be in the whole talk, it will be reversible. So M has a spectral decomposition. You can find, I hope you know all this, the spectral decomposition. The spectrum of such an operator is necessary between -1 and 1. And you have, this is EL should be seen as this vector space generated by the eigenvector associated to the eigenvalue, which has less to L. And you have the infinitesimal. You can represent any self-adjoint operator in this way. So it is ergodic. So one, as it was said before, one, you know what is the eigenvector, right? It's written here. It's at least the constant function are eigenvalue for the eigenvector for the eigenvalue 1. And then we said it is ergodic, in fact, if it is the only vector associated to 1. This is what is written here. And so we can use this projection valued measure, saying that between 1 and 1 minus, there is nothing except this the function which are constant. Okay, this is ergodic, and we'll come back maybe later. And a stronger requirement, it would say that not only just before 1 there is nothing, but there is in fact a gap between 1 and lambda, 1 minus lambda. There is in fact no eigenvalue and no continuous spectrum. And if it is happen, we say that there is a spectral gap, and the larger lambda you can take, it is called the spectral gap. So now another definition, and it will be all. We say that M is hyperbounded if it sends L2 into some LP, into some smaller space, so for P larger than 2. Usually it was for 4. P equal 4, but you can ask for any P larger than 2. So the question, which was asked by Ekron and Simon, is such an operator, which is self-adjoint, ergodic, and hyperbounded, does it have a spectral gap or not? So there is a lot of answer to this question, but in each time it was in a particular setting. But is it true in this general setting, general probability measure?
Each one said they were the general setting.
Hmm?
Each one to prove it said they were doing the general case.
No. They were saying that there was other... No. Each people who have worked on it, he was never in the general case. There is one situation which I will come back. No, maybe I didn't understand what you said. Because my... Well, it's not important. So, but in fact, it is true. The result is true in general. But maybe I can say what you will expect seeing such a result is if I have this number... So I should be able to compute the spectral gap in terms of that. But this is not true. In fact, this is, we will see why. And there is only one case which is true. It is when this is smaller than 2. Then there is an upper bound of the, a lower bound of the spectral gap in terms of this, the difference between that and 2. But this is the only case where we can, and it is due to Wang. Feng Wang, which is also the guy who asked me the question. So, yes, and Ekron and Simon, it was not for one particular Markov operator, but in fact for a family of operators which satisfies the semi-group condition. So for all real non-negative real, you have an operator PT as before, a Markov operator, which is also self-adjoint, and it satisfies this. You can think of the heat kernel, for instance. This is maybe we come back to that. So ergodicity, you know, it's more, we say that such a semigroup of family of operators is ergodic if it converges towards the equilibrium, which should be mu. This is usual ergodic, more usual than the previous one. And it has a spectral gap if this convergence, in fact, is uniform over the unit ball of L2 of mu. Okay. And we said that it is hyperbounded if there is a time such that PT is sending L2 into some smaller space, LP with P larger than 2. And the question was, in this situation, is there a spectral gap for PT? So it's just a consequence of the previous one, but I wanted to say something. But no, I won't say it. Because I will say it later. So there was a case which is very easy, is when PT is not only hyperbounded, but hypercontractive. It's not only it is continuous from L2 to L4, say, but in fact the norm is 1. As it is the case for the famous Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process, and we will come back later to that. So in this case, it was easy and well known because for people who knows, but I will maybe jump fast here. It was well known because if it is hypercontractive, in fact there is a Lok-Sobolev inequality, and a Lok-Sobolev inequality is well known to imply a spectral gap. And hyperboundedness was also known to be equivalent to some functionality inequality, but it was a Lok-Sobolev, but non-tight. You have to add something. You know Lok-Sobolev, you have the entropy on the left, or the right, left. And you have the energy, but you add the mu of F2 on the right. This is non-tight with a constant in front. So the previous result, in fact, showed that if you have a and since they are equivalent to hyperboundedness in this case of self-adjoint Markov operator, you have in fact equivalence between non-tight logarithm Sobolev inequality and in tight Sobolev inequality, but you have to change the constant, and this is non-trivial. You cannot do it in a universal way. Yes, this is the consequence. And Wang has also he has published recently. Is to be publishing another paper going in this direction also, but I want saying that, for instance, if you, a lot of inequalities, if they are non-tight, in fact, you can tight it quite easily, but you lose the constant, and you can't, there is not a universal way to transform the constant. So, so now you're coming back. There is a guy from we leave the room, but I was coming back to the finite setting for him. So the finite setting, what I said before, S is a finite set. And now we won't work with a Markov kernel, but a Markov generator. It means, so you know it's a matrix, and the matrix, outside the diagonal, the entry are non-negative. And you put in the diagonal what's needed, such that if you take the sum over the line, it is zero. Since we assume that this matrix is reversible with respect to the probability measure mu, it is in fact diagonalizable, and you consider its spectrum as before. This is zero, now the smallest eigenvalue. This is minus the spectrum of L, since we prefer to work with positive. And the Schiger inequality relates this lambda 2 to a quantity which we are computed by cutting the space in two parts. So I remember, but it was written before, but maybe the notation are not the same. So what is the conductance of a set? You take the ratio between this, so you integrate with respect to mu, or you take the sum with respect to mu in this case, over the point which are in A, and you take the point which are not in A. So maybe I should, just to see, maybe all of you already know that this is computing something, the boundary of A. This quantity is just the sum over x in A, y not in A, and you have what I call mu x, L of xy. So this is a positive quantity, and that's all. So this is just the numerator measuring the boundary of A. And here you are just the weight of A. So this division is a isoperimetric quantity, and you consider the, usually you consider this, this minimum over all A whose mass is less than 1/2. But in fact, you can write it over all set, just taking the maximum, you see, because this is symmetric between A and the complementary of A. So you get that, and this is called sometimes the Cheeger constant. And the result we have seen in the previous talk is that lambda 2 can be estimated using I2. It is less than that. This is trivial because you just consider the indicator function, as it was said. And here you have a lower bound. Here, well, I have to put L, but because you see everything is homogeneous in L. If I multiply L by something, the spectrum is multiplied by the something, the same. And also here, you see it's linear in L. So since there is a square, I have to divide by something. And this, what is that? It's the maximum value over the diagonal, for instance. Of, in probabilistic term, it's the maximum weight of getting out of a point. So, this is the famous Cheeger inequality. So what happened for the other eigenvalue? Is it possible to cut the space into n components? So we introduce this quantity. Now you divide into n components which are disjoint, which are not necessarily a partition. And you consider the maximum of the conductance. But you take the minimum. So in fact, when you will optimize, there will be all this. In a certain sense, they will be all the same, in fact, when you will make the optimization. Because if one is bigger than the other one, you just put some mass of one on the other one. But I don't want to. And so, in fact, I was wondering if there is a constant, universal constant depending on n, such that this is always true for any finite set, for any measure mu, for any kernel which is reversible. And so the answer came from either from Tetali and the Sevoal-Prasad or from the previous talk of Trevisan. So we get their result was that we can take Cn. It appeared in the previous talk it was Cn. No, it was this constant. No? Or it was 6, I don't remember. You don't remember? What? If you don't even remember, what?
That was it.
Ah, yeah, but it was a square. Ah, because, yes. Here, I take it like that, and you were using this, maybe.
Yes, but, so our square will become a fourth power.
Yeah, but in fact, it's not important. What I will need is that Cn is positive. If I give you a n, I don't care about how you compute it, but I just want it to be positive, whatever the choice. So you have shown that it is, you can take this, for instance. So it was not written in the context of Markov chain, but in context of a graph with weight. But you can go from one to the other one, especially because you permit to have loops, which enable to go from one to the other setting. So this is true. So what? How can this? And this will be the ingredient to solve the conjecture. So why it is true? So now I will consider hyperboundedness for infinite setting, which is stupid because we know that in the finite setting, L2 is sent to any to L infinity even. But what's important is you want something quantitative. So the result is the following. Now, I forget that I had a generator, but I come back to the kernel. So now the sum is 1, no longer 0. And the spectrum, so it is moved, it is between 1 and minus 1, as initially, and I call theta 1, theta 2, this eigen value. And the result is the following. Cn is a constant we have seen in the previous result of Trevisan and Equator. If you assume that you have a lot of eigen value which are close to 1, you know, if you have some n, this should be seen as something which is small. So if you have a lot of eigen value which has between 1 and this small quantity, then for any p, if you compute the norm from L2 to LP, then you can have this quantity with something which is written like that. So it should not be, say, why? So in fact, it's quite easy. If you forget that, assume that, you, as he was saying, that you have n eigen value which is equal to 1. So in fact, it means you have n set, which are not communicating between themselves. If you compute, I know it's easy to compute such a thing because it will be attained if you take some indicator of this function. Here there is A1, A2, your set. You take for F this indicator function and you take one of them is of a measure less than 1 over n. You take this one and you get this bound. This is almost immediate. And now from this case to the other case, you have to use something quantitative, and the quantitative, it was the higher order trigger, which go in the same direction. So this is a proof, but I won't jump all that. You see, it's very easy. You take the, I mean, in 3 pages, it's okay. You have understood the result. But so now it is on finite set, and you have to go to the general. To the general setting, but in fact, for Markov kernel, what you should think it's always finite. You can very well approximate it by a finite Markov chain. So first, our result, if it is worth it, I told you there won't be a quantitative bound between the spectral gap and the norm of the hyperboundedness, hyperbound. In fact, because we use an argument by contradiction. And so let's see what happened if there is no spectral gap. If there is no spectral gap, it means that between these two, for any lambda, this space, which is a projection, the space in which you are projecting, in fact, is infinite dimension. It means that the essential spectrum, if there is no spectral gap, in fact, the essential spectrum go up to 1. So there will be an infinite, this will be infinite. This is a proof, but it's just what I was saying. So now you will make an approximation. So you start, you consider some n, and we will prove something which will be true for all n. So maybe, bon, I won't enter here, but maybe I should say, or you approximate, if you have some, maybe I will go over here. So you have M, your Markov kernel, in your general state space. And you will construct a subtree sigma field, which is finite. There is an initial sigma field, and you want to approximate it by finite sigma field. So initially, I didn't say that it was separable, but since we are working with function, you are using function, and once you have a function, you have something separable, and you can make an approximation like that. So what I wanted to say, if you have a sub-sigma field and a Markov kernel, there is always, you can associate a Markov kernel at the level here. What you are doing is just you take M with a conditional expectation of that. No. Oui, c'est général procédure. Markov kernel, sub-sigma field, you can associate another one. And this operation is monotonous with respect to all the nice quantities as the spectral gap, log Sobolev quantity. doing that, in fact, the spectral gap, it will go up. So you will use such an approximation, but maybe I won't enter into the details. Quite yeah, and you are using the Martin recursion, but I don't want to go into the details. I don't know when I started and when I should stop.
You started at 10 to 4.
Well, in fact, I don't care when I started, but when I should stop.
Oh, okay. Let's say 20 to 5 and then discussion.
Ah.
Am I doing this right?
20. Yeah.
Am I doing this right? I mean, I think originally we should have started to stop it.
Yeah.
Ah, no, we should not lose.
It's the upper bound. You can, but it's a flexible upper bound.
Ah, okay. So maybe you want me to enter into the detail?
So in my book, you have half an hour left.
Ah, yeah. Maybe I will come back then to this argument later, but it's just an approximation using a sub-sigma field and the fact that if there is no spectral gap, you have an infinite choice of function which is very close to the function one. But you have to sit down and look at it, and I think it's not the time at the end of the afternoon to look at such computation. But so you see what we have done. We have used what was proven for finite Markov chain, and we extended it. We work with finite Markov chain, get an hyper bound for that, and then go to the limit. And this proves the limit this way. But we could have done the other way. It was first to extend the higher trigger inequality to the general case, because it was some question this morning. We would like at least to recover the setting of trigger, initial setting of trigger, which is a compact Riemannian manifold. So to do that, we will do the other way. We will extend first all the eigenvalue. So we define that, which is a relate ratio. M is a Markov kernel, and identity minus M should be seen as a generator, Markov generator. No? So this quantity, you recognize a Dirichlet form. And you divide the Dirichlet form by the mu of F2, and by the relate characterization of eigenvalue, T should be the eigenvalue. At least this is true for the finite setting. In the general case, maybe it's not true, because if you have an essential spectrum, once you reach the essential spectrum, you get stuck to this essential spectrum because you have an infinite number of functions. So this is not necessarily eigenvalue, but it is eigenvalue up to the essential spectrum. Okay. So this is the extension of the lambda n we have before for m. This was written. To extend the conductivity, it's also not difficult because we are returning in a way which has easily extended here. You take from A and complementary of A. So there is no problem with this connectivity. And we define, as before, the spectrum, connectivity spectrum. You divide in, to compute this value, you divide your space into n parts, and you take the minimum of all this cutting. Well, maybe it's not a partition, but you take, there is a mean, it's a mean max principle, something like that. Okay? But it's defined as before. So now, in fact, using the same approximation procedure as before, there is no difficulty to extend the Trevisan bound to the general case, and you get that. But since we would like to work with Laplacian is not a Markov operator, it's a Markov generator. So we should go from the heat semigroup, for instance, we would like to go to the generator. So is it possible? In fact, for the spectrum, there is no difficulty because due to functional calculus, you see, if L is a given a Markov semigroup, if L is a generator, since we have everything is self-adjoint, the nth eigenvalue or the nth in the previous sense eigenvalue is just related to the one of the semi-group, well, this is just elementary computation, just a limit, and there is nothing. But this one, we recognize this quantity from just functional calculus. Okay? So here, you see, it would be easy to go to the limit. Anyway, a generator is always understood as something which is for T small. And here, everything is okay. But it's not true for the connectivity spectrum. For this one, things are very bad. Because you see, for the connectivity spectrum, in fact, you are using indicator function of set. And this goes very bad to the limit when T is small. So we have to find something else. So the idea is to introduce another spectrum, which is between the connectivity spectrum and the usual spectrum. So in the connectivity spectrum, we were using this ratio of this isoperimetric ratio. We will replace it by something which is more spectral, which is called the lambda zero. So what is the lambda zero? So assume you have still your Markov kernel, and you have a set. And yes, I should say that lambda zero of M of A, for those who are working probability, this is given the weight of a Markov chain associated to M to get out of A. And analytically, it is defined like that. You take the infimum of all functions which are zero outside your set. And you take the infimum of such function of the ratio of the Dirichlet form by the mu of F2. In the Riemannian setting, for instance, if here it was Laplacian, since the Laplacian, the diffusion is not jumping, you just have to, the usual definition is to be zero on the boundary. But here, since we know nothing, it jumps and it's still a kernel. You have to put zero outside the set. You take that and you replace before, well, in the definition when you add the connectivity, you replace it by this lambda zero. This lambda zero, as you see from the definition, is really a spectral notion. In fact, it is the smallest Dirichlet eigenvalue associated to A. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it was also proven by Tracy. Yeah, and this quantity, yes, it's funny because it was introduced, I introduced it with to study something, and it was introduced independently by Elfer in the context of Laplacian of several funny space. Because you can, if you put the Laplacian, everything is okay, the definition, but to compute what are the sets such that this is attained, it's not so easy. Even for the sphere, you take the sphere and you want to divide it into three parts. What are, I think they don't know. Well, so
these guys lie below the eigenvalues. Hmm? They lie below the eigenvalues, the case
eigenvalue? I didn't say, but there will be a relation between them. That's a big lambda. It's not, this is not the eigenvalue, but in fact, yes, they will serve to approximate the eigenvalue. And in fact, you have from the theorem one in the beautiful paper of Trevisan and company. Ah, really beautiful when I read it. Oh, because I tried to prove it for some time. So when you try for several years to prove something and to find a paper who prove it finally, you say, oh. Well, bon. So they prove it, of course, for graph, for people from here. But you can extend by the same procedure as before because the procedure is really, there's no problem with it. But now we have an advantage. And you see, there is no square. And this is important, in fact. In fact, the idea why this is true, it came from a simulated annealing. Maybe I will give an explanation why it is true after that. But it's important there is no square, and you see they are really in the same. This is very more interesting than Cheeger inequalities. So what I'm writing here? Yeah. So now, yes. The fact it is spectral, the approximation for small t, it will be okay. That's the idea. So here I entered into the text. If you have a semigroup, general semigroup, you can consider, and you have a subset, you can consider the semigroup, Dirichlet semigroup associated to C-self. You take a function, you don't care what's outside A, so multiply by the indicator function, and when PT, you just consider the restriction to A. If you have a Markov chain doing that, in A, you let your Markov chain evolve, and when it's getting out of A, you just send it to the cemetery, and it's all over. and you have also, you can know with such, this is now also a semigroup, some Markovian semigroup, because you are killed sometimes. But you can do all the limiting when T is going to zero. And you have, you can, you said, you can define directly the lambda zero of a generator, and you find it in the limit for small t with using the corresponding Dirichlet semigroup. And this is important because doing that, you can go to here now, you can go to the limit for t small, and you get that with generator. And this is important. But it's not still the trigger, usual trigger inequality, because this is this quantity, which is not the trigger. And you would like to come back to the trigger inequality. So we are not completely done yet. So to come back to the trigger of the 1970. So the setting, what is the setting? You take a compact Riemannian manifold. Compact because you don't want to have, don't know, someone said, if you take the Laplacian, you will have the essential spectrum, but to kill the essential spectrum, you take the compact manifold. So there is no problem. it generates the heat semigroup. And yes, in the definition, since it is smoothing, instead of considering any subset, which can be embarrassing, you can consider subset, you know, when you say A1, A2, etc., you just take subsets which are smooth, who are really a boundary in the Riemannian. It doesn't change the definition of the lambda, the big lambda. So now, assume you have such a set which is regular, and you have your Laplacian. Here it should be the Laplacian here. Then you can come back to the result of trigger, look at the proof, it's not difficult, and you find that in fact, for A, you can find a B inside A such that this ratio, which is the ratio, isoperimist ratio, and this is the measure, the Hausdorff dimension, D minus one Hausdorff dimension associated to compute the boundary. You take such ratio, you can find a B such that this is less than that square, because this is the square in the trigger. So using that, you see, you have the lambda n, but inside for each ai which appear, you can find a bi. So it needs to consider for the en equivalent of trigger constant, you just define that with this, okay? Is it okay for everybody, or if you say no, okay? And then, even Tetali is not saying yes.
Yeah. Say again. What's the last observation? I'm sorry.
No. We here we define the en. We cannot define it as a limit for t small, but we define it using the. Since we are in a Riemannian setting, you can define that. Or more generally, I think you can use, you know, this lambda plus, they are all doing people you're in concentration. You can define that in more generally, but here, just for Riemannian. So this is the ratio, really, of the measure. You have really a set like that now in the Riemann. It's no longer, as before, something like that. See here, before it was the edge, the boundary. Now it's a true boundary. You are measuring like that. And you take this ratio as usual. Yeah. If you take n equal 2, it's really the quantity appearing in the trigger paper. N equal 2, yes, n equal 2. So now you can, using the previous the fact that lambda 0 can be approximated by such quantity to the square, it's easy to by using the previous result of Trevisan, to go and to find really a trigger inequality for the nth eigen value, which was the question this morning. So it is true. And not only that, but you know that there is a result of Busser saying there is another bound in the other direction. For n equal 2, the spectral gap is bounded above by that. And here you have to add k is minus k is the lower bound of the Ricci curvature. You have that. Especially if you have a positive curvature, you see here there is not this quantity. And in fact, the lambda n is really equivalent to the En. I don't know what they were saying before. So this is a case where really this is not like En. This is really as En squared when they are going to zero. So maybe the question before, it was if you have a for graph with a positive Ricci curvature, you cannot do well. And this also, it's proven in the same way, not using a Buzer paper, but the one of Ledoux. Since Ledoux is paying my travel, I have to do no, but I really take the, because his proof is based on a semigroup. And the semigroup, as we have seen, it's really important. This is the way we have defined the lambda zero. So everything goes, you have the same result. And the C here depends only on the dimension, not on n, because it is really the same proof. You have to change something, nothing. Two lines, and it's OK.
It uses some curvature dimension inequality or something, no?
No, what?
Ledoux's proof.
Let me see. There is a curvature here. And the dimension is in D, in C. But it doesn't depend on N, and the curvature you have here. It. So maybe something like that, is it true for Markov generator on graph? But, well, what's more important, that's Witten Laplacian. That's all the idea came to consider such quantities. So now you no longer you still keep your Riemannian compact Riemannian manifold, but you add a drift, which is a gradient of a function. So you are given a function on your manifold. You take the gradient and you add the inverse temperature beta. So that is now the reversible measure. I think I write it somewhere. No. Ah, no, it's a Gibbs measure. The invariant measure is like that. It's minus beta u and lambda. Lambda, it's a Riemannian measure.
Where does it appear, this Witten Laplacian?
Where is it?
Where did it appear? Is it the paper on Morsiwi?
Yeah, because this is acting on function. In fact, it was acting on one form, two form, so that you extend it. But since it was... In fact, you should, well, because it is the influence of Elfer for me, that I is saying that it's Witten Laplacian, but we were calling it in another way before, I don't remember. But the Witten Laplacian, maybe it would be, yes, it was for Morse theory and acting on one form, but here there's no one form, we just use a function. And it is an operator which is self-adjoint into L2 of mu beta, and mu beta is this quantity. The u is here. So now you can wonder what is the behavior of the eigenvalue for beta large. So there was a famous paper by Ole and Struck would say that this is the second, I change notation each time. So you have zero eigenvalue and you look at the next one, the spectral gap. And they were saying that in some sense, this is a C beta, well, there is something here, the power in beta, we don't, just that. And what is C? So here, usually you draw a picture like that. So what is C? Here you have the infimum of U somewhere, the global infimum of U, and you look at the well which doesn't contain this global minima. So, and you look at the one which has the height is the largest. So where it is here, I should take someone. No, you see it is here. This is a well. What is a well? It is a set such that all points inside the set for you, they are below the boundary, and the boundary is constant. Here, by example, the boundary says there is only 2 points in the boundary, say it is T2 point, and you are below, and the 8 is a bit different between the bottom and the value at the boundary. And this is give you the C. But more generally,
wait,
I should say.
The absolute minimum is achieved. What's wrong with taking?
You take a well, you take the bottom of the well, and you take the well which doesn't intersect this one. Or you can see it another way. You take two wells, you try to put two wells in your space such that, and this, they are the two wells, you take the same 8, so there are two here, and this is, if you take a L with a 8 larger, it's not possible. This is a critical one.
The deepest well is where you will mix. So the other one is where
stuck
at any mix.
Metastability.
Yeah. But you should see, it's better to see it, not one particular, you should see there is a two. Because if you want here now K, what you will do, you will put, so you see it from above, you put K well, there is a 8 which is critical, so you can find K well with the same 8. And this is in fact giving this coefficient here. This is this. And you see, if you compute, I don't know, if you can compute the lambda zero of this, the lambda zero of that is also has the same behavior. That explains why the quantity lambda n are well related, because they behave at the exponential level, they have the same. And also the same as En. But if you use something like that, En square, you have lost something in the weight. That's why the lambda n is better. And you can find the... So this was, for me, it was the motivation, which is not the same motivation as the people from graph theory. So maybe I will come back to... So there is nothing quantitative, as you have seen. In fact, when I showed Bakri this result, he said necessarily it is wrong because it's not quantitative. Bon. So I said there is one particular case where it is quantitative, and this is a result due to Wang. Now we take the traditional P equal 4. You go from L2 to L4. And if this, I said something wrong, you have to put the power 4 here. If this is smaller than 2, then you can find a lower bound of the spectral gap in terms of the difference between 2 and this number. But it is, you cannot do better, because if you are given some k which is larger than 2, you can find a Markov kernel such that he has for upper bound this k, and the spectral gap is as small as you want.
And this proposition is not in the other direction of the conjecture?
No, because for... each one, you will find there is an epsilon. It will not be zero. But for any small... it just saying that the theorem is not quantitative. You cannot have a quantitative version. And it's not... don't believe that the Markov kernel is very fancy or not. No, it's just on 2 points. You just take the general case on 2 points, putting any measure, any kernel. But any kernel, they are very easy on 2 points. And it's either of this formula. There you go. You make optimization over everything, and you find this result, showing that the result of Wang was optimal. Because after the two, there is a link between epsilon and k, but not before. So, as it was mentioned in the previous result, or the three previous results, in fact, you see, before the result, there was always the same indices. There was a lambda n and an. But you can move a little one. He said in the talk before, 1.1. You can put 1.1. There is the 0.1 should be in the constant here, but once you have one. So there is another result saying, lambda 2n is larger than e squared 2n, but with something better here, which is a logarithm, and no longer a power. And as they have shown, this is in fact optimal. You cannot replace that by something going slower, slow, which would be, well, in the good direction. I can't say. And they were using hypercontractivity result to, due to Bonamy and Bechner. But we will recover the fact that it is optimal using, in fact, semi-group. So how we will do it? Ah, yes, there is, in fact, a quantitative version, but the quantitative version won't give you an estimate on the spectral gap, but on another eigenvalue. So here it is the result. Ah, so you want is something... just for faire malin. But you can consider not LP, but you can consider more generally Orlitz space. Orlitz space, which should be smaller than L2. So you take a function, Jung function phi, which is such that in comparison to R2 is going to plus infinity. So it means that the Orlitz space associated to this function is really smaller than the L2 initially. So you are wondering, I am going from L2 to this other one. So yes, if, so here is the, quantitative version. If Kn, Kn is related directly to the function phi, if there is something like that, then I can give an, a lower bound on lambda to n using the previous constant. This is the same computation as before. In particular, you see there is no, the essential spectrum is not going up to 1 because you have one true eigenvalue which is not not to 0, which is not... yeah, not this one here. And the spectrum, yeah, yeah. So there is a quantitative version, but not the spectral gap. But it's sufficient to prove the result, in fact, we were needed. So now let's come back to the famous Hochstein and Beck result. The result of Nelson and Gross says the following. If I'm looking from L2 to LP, I can find a T which is critical. Before this T, in fact, the norm is plus infinity, and after this T, it is hyper-contractive. So it's quite yes, a radical transition. You see, it's plus infinity and 1. If you want something more subtle, you can consider this Orlitz, the Orlitz space associated to this function. Then you have that this quantity to going to the special Orlitz space is going to plus infinity, but it's not plus infinity or 1 directly. So using that... so now you consider the Hochstein. Oh, but I didn't say, but everybody knows what the Hochstein and Beck process. This is the generator is this one. And it's not wrong. You take some P and T, you put it in the machine described before, and you get a quantitative bound saying that the nth eigenvalue of the Hochstein and Beck is bounded by some quantity, and the quantity, in fact, is a constant because you have log n, and remember, this is C tilde n, but they are both of the same, so this is a constant. So it seems very bad as a bound because we know that lambda n, what is lambda n? Someone which is not sleeping. lambda n, for the Hochstein and Beck, it's n. The eigenvalue are n, etc. So here it's bad. Here it's growing as n, and here I have just a constant. So I say, maybe I missed something. Maybe the C tilde could be improved. Well, you know, it cannot be improved, but maybe it could be improved. And in fact, no, it's not true because, you know, the hyperconstructivity, in fact, is stable by tensorization. Now, if I tensorize the semigroup, what's happening for the, if I tensorize n times, you know, the spectral gap would be n times the same initially. So here, you apply the same result, and if you add something which was going to infinity, you would have a contradiction because here you would be stuck to a constant. So it proves that you cannot improve the result either of the previous one or the previous one. Well, we stop here, and it's the last.
So I think you use hyperconductivity, but not for LB and L2, but for some Orlitz.
I use here for this result. I use usual hyperconductivity.
No, but few slides ago.
Yeah.
And I remember also Frank Barth had some works about this hyperconductivity for these OLED spaces.
Ah, yeah. You have a modified Luxobolev with a function which is not x. In the entropy, you don't put x log x. You put another function related to the function phi. Or you can do it here, or you can modify the energy. And this is equivalent to this kind of.
So my question is, are there applications for this in the discrete setting, the combinatorial setting, computer science, or probability, all the things we are
interested in? I don't know. But I will think of it. Thinking of you, I should find
out. L2, L4, the critical parameters when the fourth power of the norm is less than 2, that the 2 is critical.
Yeah.
And what would it be, for example, for the operator going from L2 to L6? No critical values for others.
I think you can do the same. We were just working with 2 points. You just do the same computation with 2 points, and you will end up, I think, with...
So it would be like Gaussian minus 1? What would be the answer for
Let's see where it was. Oh, no. Okay. Certainly if the 4 is replaced by 6, certainly there is something replacing the 2. Uh-huh. But you have to compute it. To compute it, you will see it on 2 points. Uh-huh. I think there is no reason why it's not special, the 4. The 2 points is not the square root of 4, I mean.
The question was maybe it's moments of the Gaussian.
Doesn't seem they need a Gaussian here because you need 2 points to understand what's.
But we know often a Gaussian is simpler than 2 points.
You have listened to what he's saying?
Yeah, it's like.
Currently, that is a tragedy, but it's
quite.
Like, a Gaussian is a
warm up
to.
Yeah, but Gross was using 2 points first.
Which is a warm up for 1 point.
Okay. It's watching the kindergarten, huh?
So I think we are ready for the day. Thank you.